Welcome, everybody. We are now beginning session four of our summer writing series. Our focus today is one that I think you're going to enjoy very much. It might be one of your favorite sessions of the summer series. It's when you start a story, how do you develop and bring to life the main character? It's one of the biggest challenges that writers face. It's also some of the most fun that writers get to have when they are writing. When I talk to my students in writing workshop in our class, I challenge them to make the character as real as possible so that even though you're making them up, they are fictional, you in your mind honestly believe they are a real person. And I point to the classroom door and I say, if your character walks into that door, walks into the room, do you know what they look like? Do you know how they walk? Do you know how they act? Do you know what they wear? Are they real? And if you've done that, your story is going to benefit from that. So today we're going to focus on ways to bring your stories to life with excellent main characters. If you've been in my class before, you've seen some of this, but I'm pulling out some new tricks today that I've never shared before in my life, and I'm incredibly excited to get started. So we're going to start with the screen sharing. Here's my initial advice on how to develop a main character. One word you might hear in your classes is not develop a main character, it's describe a main character. We're trying to move away from description and move toward developing, and I'll explain why in a second. So first bullet point, when you think of your main character, there's hundreds of things that you could think about them, how they look, how they act, how they talk, what their personality's like, but you want to start with what matters most to you. What are their most important traits? And if you're treating this as a work session, you want to write that down, you can start jotting down some important things about the main character. Then you have to be sure that they fit together so that they seem real and believable. You don't want to be in a situation where you say, okay, my main character is 10 years old. She's a top-notch chef. She speaks 5 languages. She gets up every morning and swims for 2 hours before school. She reads for 3 hours every day after school. She never makes a mistake. Then she goes home. She does her homework. She always goes on play dates. She has soccer practice 3 times a week. It's like, wait a minute. That's not believable. That's way too much. That doesn't quite fit together. So you want to be sure that what you say about your character really is true of a real person and their life really is like the life of an actual person. The next thing is a lesson that I learned when I first wrote Chase Against Time, because someone said this to me. They said, you have to be careful that your main character doesn't come across as too perfect. You don't want your main character to come across as too good to be true. So if you read Chase Against Time, you'll know that there's a part where he says something about the detective shows that he likes to watch on TV when his parents aren't really looking. That was not part of the original story, but I put that in because it made him not perfect, because sometimes kids will do things that they're not supposed to. So I put in something that he did that he wasn't supposed to. I also put in a few times when he kind of cracked a joke that might not have been the nicest thing in the whole world. He was a little bit of a smart aleck every now and then. That also makes sure that the character is not too good to be true. So you want your character to be believable and real. Finally, you want to be sure you know what your character wants. What are they going for? What's their goal during the story? And then what are their struggles? You want to give them weaknesses or problems that they have to overcome. That also connects to the idea that they're not too perfect. They've got to have something that gets in their way or keeps them from getting what they want. Okay, I'm going to stop sharing for just a second, just to see if we have people waiting, and we do. So let me just bring them in here. And then we're going to go right to our next slide. Hang on just a sec. All righty. Now, once you are through checking out this advice for developing a character, you want to avoid a trap. And this is one of my favorite pictures that I'm going to share with you today. This man is trying to step over a trap. And let's face it, he has enough problems. He doesn't have a face. He doesn't have any eyes, nose, or mouth, or ear. So he's got some things going against him. But he's stepping in something that he doesn't want to step into. And I call it the hair color, eye color trap. If you were in my class last year, you've heard what this is. This happens with young writers. When somebody says, okay, you have a main character, tell me about your main character. And then instantly, the first two things out of our mouth, hair color, eye color. Oh, I can tell you about my main character. Blonde hair, brown eyes. Now, that's a beginning, but it's not enough by far, not nearly enough to bring your character to life. Because if you closed your eyes and you pictured a character with blonde hair and blue eyes, you could envision a little bit, but you know nothing else about the character. It is nowhere near enough. So we want to avoid the trap, and we want to, again, avoid what I said before. We're not just describing what they look like. That's a part of it. It's an important part of it, but we want to develop them. We want to give them a believable personality. I'm now going to share with you several strategies on how to do that. You can pick and choose which ones you think you like the best, or you're welcome to try them all. The first one, this is one that is brand new. I've never shared this before, and I'm so excited to share it. It's called finding a comp, meaning a comparable person to your main character. Somebody that you can compare your main character to, because if you think of a character from scratch, it's really hard. I did that a few times in Chase Against Time, and there's a better way of doing it. I did my best character work when I thought of somebody who the character would be like, and then I changed it around. It's a good starting point. Here's an example from the world of professional sports, because if you're like me, you're very interested in sports. This is a guy named Joe Burrow. He just finished playing college football. He was the first person picked in the NFL draft, and he's going to be playing next season in Cincinnati for the Bengals. Now, for people who do not know anything about Joe Burrow, it's kind of hard to think about him. But if I said to you, oh, Joe Burrow is comparable to Tom Brady, well, for a lot of you, you have a lot more information now. You might know that he's a smart player. He's got a good throwing arm. He's a good leader. He's a winner. So just by connecting one person to another, I think of a lot of information right away. Now, my favorite example from Chase Against Time is the character Brock Fuller, who's a little angry. He's a tough guy. And I didn't really know too much about him, but I knew that there was a pro wrestler named Brock Fuller. So I'm thinking, okay, the reason I named him Brock Lesnar is because Brock Fuller was his comp. Now, obviously, Brock Fuller is a little bit too big to be in fifth grade, maybe just a little bit. But if I think about his personality, I'm not copying it. You never want to copy a character's personality, but you want to use it as a starting point, or you can use it as a starting point. So starting from that face, in that strength, I developed the character of Brock Fuller. Yes, I see some of your eyes rolling because this guy's pretty intimidating. That's what I was going for with Brock Fuller. So if you think about your main character, you might want to take a minute now to jot down some ideas. Who is somebody like your main character that could be their comp, their comparable person that you can use as a starting point, even though you're going to change it around after? Okay, let me unshare for a sec so I can bring in some new people. All right, let's go back to Brock Fuller because he's fun to look at. So after my comp, then I can keep going. Here's the next strategy. This is something called an internal-external chart. It makes sure that when we bring our character to life, it's not just what they look like. So the internal side on the left is what they're like on the inside. You can't see this by looking at them because it's not visible on the outside. It's what they're like on the inside. The external side is what you see on the outside. So I told you last time that I was writing a story about a woman named Christy Turner who wanted to become a naval pilot. Here's her character, internal, external chart. She has short brown hair. She does have a green eyes, but I'm not going to fall into the trap of stopping there. That's just the starting point. She's 22 years old. She's not really into clothes. She's into being a pilot. So I just had her wear plain clothes. And then I told you that it's important for your characters not to be perfect. They need weaknesses or challenges. Hers is that she's not very physically strong. She's not muscular. And she's going to have to be if she's going to get over that wall on the obstacle course to pass her program and become a pilot. So I did that one in blue. So if you're doing any kind of internal external chart, it's a good idea to do their wants in blue, which I did on the left, and their challenges or their struggles in blue, because that makes sure that you won't, that'll remind you to put them in your story and not forget about it. Now on the left, what does she want? She wants to be a pilot. So now that I know that, I can round out the rest of her character. Now you got to know a lot of math and science to be a pilot. So I said she was a strong science student, The next one's a little bit heavy, not really something we think about as kids, but maybe she wanted to kind of prove to her father that she was worthy of doing this really challenging job because she never felt that he appreciated her. Like, that's kind of a sad situation. She loves her country. She's patriotic. That's why she's joining the Navy. And then she's used to succeeding at everything she tries. This is the first time in her life where she doesn't, where this is the first time in her life she really encounters a challenge that pushes her and that makes her doubt herself. So this is one way to start developing your character, coming up with an internal external chart. I have 5 bullet points on each side, but there's really no magic number. I wouldn't do 2, but I would have at least 4 or 5, and I'd probably do more. The more you do, the more real they're going to become. Again, you want it to fit together so they are a real person. Let me stop for a second, see if there's anybody wanting to come in. There's not. We'll keep going. Here is something that you can do once you have your character, your internal external chart. This will look familiar to you if you've been in my class. On the left, you see the story arc that I mentioned last time. It's our story plan. You can take what you know about the main character and make a matching character arc on the right. The bullet points match up perfectly to the ones next to it. So for example, in the story arc, the story starts when Christy arrives at the Navy base for training. How's she doing at that time? Well, if you look on the right, she's feeling confident. She's ready to go. Well, then what happens? The training begins and it's really hard. She can't get over the wall. Well, she's changing. Now she's experiencing failure for the first time. She's not as confident. Then what happens? A stronger classmate commits to helping her and they become friends. Well, she's beginning to question herself. She's thinking of quitting. Then they put in extra practice. So here she's really digging deep. So what I'm doing is putting on the right how the character is feeling or doing at each stage on the left. That helps you have a character change. You do not want your characters, especially if you're a little bit older, if you're in first grade or second grade, it's perfectly fine for the characters not to change. But once you get into third, fourth, fifth grade and beyond, the characters should be different at the end of the story compared to the beginning because of what they've gone through and because of what they've achieved or overcome. Next, this is a page from what I've been sharing with your parents. It's my ultimate mystery writing guide for kids or ultimate mystery writing course for kids. This is something my friend helped me develop. He's a movie writer. And he helped me make what's called this three-dimensional bone structure. Okay, nobody's waiting. Let's go back to the screen share. This is one of the things I'm especially excited to share with you. This is like an internal external chart, but it goes way beyond it. So if you truly want to spend time developing a character, I would use this and not an internal external chart because you can do more with it. This is called three-dimensional because there's 3 parts, even though it's flat. It's not technically 3D. On the left is the psychological bone. It talks about what's in the character's mind. So your eyes can follow me in the top left. What are their hopes and ambitions? What do they want? What are their fears or frustrations? Do they have any hobbies? What are their strengths? What are their weaknesses? You don't need to fill in all of these, but you definitely need to fill in at least one about some form of frustration or weakness. Because again, we don't want the character to be too perfect and we want there to be something that they have to overcome. What's their temperament like? Are they easygoing? Are they calm? Are they fiery? Do they look at the bright side of things? Are they optimistic? Do they look at the downside of things? Are they pessimistic? And then the last one, what makes them different? You can think about all your classmates and friends at school. Every one of them has something that's unique to their personality. So if you filled in a few of those on the left, that's a really good start. Moving over to the right, this is about their family or their background. It's called the sociological bones. And I was in college, I studied something called sociology. It's a lot of fun. So do they have a job or do they have responsibilities? If there's a kid, maybe they don't have a paying job, but maybe they do chores. Then we can, if you want to focus on race or ethnicity, you're welcome to include that. Same with religion. Sometimes the income level really matters in a story. Sometimes it doesn't. If you know the story of Charlie and the Chocolate Factory, if his family was rich, that story wouldn't be very interesting because you wouldn't root for him. He already has a lot of money and things in his life like Veruca Salt does. But because Charlie's family is so poor and they're struggling so much, then you root for him because he really doesn't have very much as far as possessions go. So sometimes it really matters if the character has a certain income level. Same thing with the home life. Maybe you want to make your character an only child. Maybe you want to give them siblings. It depends if you have a reason for it or not. Maybe it connects to your story. Maybe it doesn't. The bottom one is where you can get into the looks of the main character. You can use the stick figure to draw what they look like, name, gender, age, hair, eye color. The bottom two are interesting because you can get into some really interesting things. Is there a word you would use to describe their appearance? Are they kind of a messy kid that just throw their clothes on in the morning? Maybe the knees have holes in them because they're always diving on the ground at recess and they're kind of messy and dirty, the clothes are, which is fine. Or maybe they have something on their body that's a little different. Maybe they have a birthmark on their knee or their neck, or they have braces or glasses or freckles or moles. These are interesting things to give each character their own personality. Okay, let me stop for a second. Then another thing that I'm really excited to share with you. Okay. This is something that I had not shared in the last few years. So if you were in my class, you probably haven't seen this. We talked about character change. These are different kinds of changes. And it's really interesting if you want to get into this in your story. The first type of change that the character can have from the beginning of the story to the end is a physical change. They actually get stronger. A great example that you might know from watching cartoons as a kid is Popeye. Popeye starts off one way, he eats his spinach, he gets a lot stronger and more muscular. So your character can have a change throughout the story, which can be really good if they have a physical challenge that they want to accomplish, like climbing up a mountain or lifting some weights or playing some kind of sport. Sometimes the change isn't physical, it's more on the inside. It's an inner strength. Maybe the character doesn't have courage at the beginning of the story and they're scared of something, but they overcome it and they become more courageous. That would be an inner strength change. Third, the change could be emotional. Maybe the character starts off a little immature. They think only of themselves, but then they become more mature and they think beyond their own needs. If you're familiar with the Chet Gecko series, you'll see a change like that. Four, a moral change. Morals have to do with what's right and what's wrong. Maybe at the beginning of the story, the character does wrong things and they don't care or they don't know any better. But throughout the story, they develop a conscience. They care more about doing right and not doing wrong. So that could be the type of change. My story that I'm doing now, my basketball story, I just finished chapter 11 today, which I'm very excited about. That's a social change. My main character, Blake Hunter, isn't really responsible with his team at the beginning. He cares only about himself. But when he encounters some difficulties, he's becoming more responsible to his group, or he will in the next few chapters. So that's a social change. And then if you've ever read the Magic Treehouse books, the main characters are Jack and Annie. Sometimes the characters have to learn how to do something to solve a problem. Maybe they're caught in a different time period and have to time travel and have to learn how to build the time machine. Or maybe they have to develop an app to solve the problem of the story. So it's a learning change. So this is one you might want to spend time on when you think about your character changes. Let me do one more check to see if anybody's coming in. Yes. And then we're going to head to the finish. And I'll be happy to read your questions and comments in the chat and then talk with you after. Okay, here we go into our finish today. One thing that some kids like to do is called a quote-unquote backstory. That means you write about what happened in the character's life before the story actually starts. So if your character is 10 years old, what happened in their life between birth and the age of 10? If they're 15 years old, what happened when they were a kid and before they were a teenager? Now, you don't want to talk about their whole life story. You want to focus on the parts of their backstory that connect to the current story. So for example, let's pretend you're writing a story about a child who is especially protective of animals. Everywhere they go, they look out for animals because they want to be sure they're protected. Now, the reader might wonder, how did they get to be that way? Why do they love animals so much? Why do they care so much about protecting them? Well, maybe when they were 5 years old, they were on some kind of family trip and they saw something that was very difficult to see. They noticed an animal getting badly hurt, and it had a major effect on them. It made them so sad that from then on, they became protective of animals and looked out for them. So if you do a backstory, it doesn't have to be a 15-page backstory. You can if you want to, even though you may never use any of it in the actual story. But it helps you think through the character's personality and their background, and it could give them more motivation or make them more interesting once the story actually starts. Finally today, we get into who is telling your story. Many kids do stories that have a narrator. That's called the third person. Something like, once upon a time, there was a boy named Johnny. That's the narrator talking about somebody named Johnny. I'm suggesting that you do what's called first person, where the main character is the one to tell the story. Because when you do that, you can open up the thinking of the character. You can kind of get inside the head of your character much better. So if you can have the main character tell the story and use words like I and me and my, I think that's a better way to go. When I first wrote Chase Against Time, I did a third person story, and here it is. This is from chapter one of the original Chase Against Time, and it's a narrator talking about a boy named Chase, starting with, this whole situation had Chase worried. His older brother and sister had each been a part of Mrs. Washington's winning orchestras when they attended Apple Valley, and Chase was hoping desperately to have his turn when he entered fifth grade. Since kindergarten, Chase dreamed of playing the cello for Mrs. Washington. There is nothing wrong with having third person, but when I signed my contract with the publisher, the first thing the editor said was change the whole book, rewrite the whole book. And that was a little bit hard to hear. Like, whoa, you want me to rewrite the whole book? That's going to take a long time. But she said, you have to write it from Chase's viewpoint, not a narrator's. So I did. It took a long time. But once I did that, I started adding in internal thinking. So then you see the second paragraph here. It's not a narrator talking about Chase. It's Chase saying, after waiting my whole life to play cello for Mrs. Washington in the Honors Orchestra and to compete in the state music competition, I couldn't bear to think of having our entire instrumental music program eliminated. That couldn't happen at Apple Valley. Not now. The timing was too cruel. So you're connecting with him and his emotion, and you can do that when the main character tells the story. Okay, our timing is perfect. I am now going to stop. Let's do what we did last time. If you have any questions or comments, please type them in the chat. I'd love to read a couple of them out loud, stop the recording, and then I'll read the rest of them. And then I will be happy to chat with you voice to voice if you need to. Yes, if you're asking to talk privately at the end, that would be great. Good afternoon. Good afternoon to you as well. A lot of kind people leaving me nice messages. Okay, I'm now going to